you talked about being, you know, the only woman going to school in that community that you lived in, and your experience pretty much around being the only as you graduated through business life. I work a lot with women who talk about how stressful that experience is, how challenging that experience is. I would love to hear your story of growing up as an only. How have you made that work, and what feedback or tidbits would you have for the next generation?
So, you know, my time, there were hardly any women doing anything, and particularly where I came from. When I got pregnant and had a baby, I was the first woman partner to get pregnant. So this was a unique experience for all the males around. And many of the clients, I'll never forget walking into the boardroom, and this is later on, this is the early 90s when I went in as part of my company, walking into the boardroom of this management team. All the secretaries, the first day I walked in, and my office was next to the CEO, all the secretaries came there with a cake, and they all clapped because this was the first woman that had ever sat in the corner. So everybody clapped because for them this was a seminal moment. And you know, of course, I had my own ignorance to deal with, which is cultural ignorance. I didn't know the country, I didn't know the language, I didn't know a lot of things, and I had to learn. I was young, so I had to learn a lot. And this is not women or gender related, but I had to learn a lot. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to acknowledge that was a part of it. But people had never seen anybody like me. I was this brown, weird woman who spoke funny, who spoke fast, who spoke random words that they couldn't understand. And especially when I was in the South and when I was in different parts of America, they would all try to educate me. So I learned a lot. But I think the big lesson I learned, and I had many of these issues of feeling alone, but I had to go through an entire thought process, because in many cases, many of the clients that I worked with, and many of the executives, and wasn't just clients, all levels of people, they didn't have a common ground with me. Mm-hmm. So they would go into awkward moves to try to find a common ground. So very often they would talk to me about cows. They would talk to me about, you know, this was before the age of the internet, mind you. Now, I could have approached it two ways. I could have taken it as a microaggression, because some of them bordered on that. I gave everyone a pass. I gave them the benefit of doubt. I said, okay, you want to understand about cows? Let me tell you about cows. You want to understand about a red dot? I'll tell you about a red dot. This just became a very disarming sort of thing. But I think it wasn't that they were trying to put me down. You could have looked at it that way.
Right.
They just were trying to find a common ground. Once you started to approach people that way, my entire relationship changed. There were still some outliers on either direction, but in general, I'm going back now 30, 40 years, some of them are still my best friends. So I would say for me, the biggest learning and the biggest liberation for me was getting control of my mind, mm-hmm. and knowing that I'm fantastic. I am perfection, and it doesn't matter. I'm not going to worry. I'm not disadvantaged.
Right.
I'm different, but I'm not disadvantaged. That is something, yes. It's an affirmation I used initially. Now it's part of me, but I'm different.
Right.
That doesn't make me disadvantaged. So I never approach this. And I think this is a big lesson for women, because a lot of women come in feeling disadvantaged.